Ma'am, possible po ba na ma-record po yung reporting po? Yes, anak. I'm recording. So, dalawa yung ipopost ko later doon. Mine kanina and then itong kina Ma'am Kim for module 4.
So, good afternoon, ma'am. Good afternoon, everyone. So, today we will be talk about measures of association together with Ma'am Almira Ruiz, Ma'am Kimberly Clydel Quezon, and yours truly po, Angel Balisi. So, for the objectives, by the end of this module, learners should be able to define and explain the concept of measures of association in epidemiology, identify and describe common measures of association, including relative risk, odds ratio, and hazard ratio. Understand the interpretation and application of measures in epidemiological research. Evaluate the strengths and limitations and different measures of association in various study designs and concepts. So to begin with, what is a measures of association? Measures of association refers to statistical metrics used to quantify the relationship between an exposure or the risk factor or protective factor and an outcome, which is a disease or health condition within a population. So we have three concepts, some measures of association. We have identify potential risk factors for disease, evaluate the effectiveness of interventions or treatments, and inform public health policies and recommendations. So there are three measures of association. We have relative risk, odds ratio, and hazard ratio. These three serve as valuable tools for epidemiologists to assess the strength of relationship between exposures and outcomes, providing insights that contribute to our understanding of disease causation, prevention, and control. So meron po tayong anim na factors in interpreting measures of association. We have confounding, effect modification, statistical significance, assess the clinical or public health significance of the observed associations, potential biases in study, and data collection. So number one for the measures of association, we have relative risk. So relative risk is a measure used to quantify the strength of association between an exposure and an outcome, and usually ginagamit po to sa cohort studies and clinical trials. So ang ating formula for the RR or relative risk o mas sinatawag din natin sa tawag na risk ratio is RR is equal to risk in exposed group divided by risk in unexposed group. For the interpretation, we have RR of 1 is equal to no association. For greater than 1, we have increased risk. And for the less than 1 is for decreased risk. It is commonly used in cohort studies and clinical trials to assess the impact of exposures on disease risk. It helps researchers evaluate effectiveness of interventions, identify risk factors, and inform preventive measures. So, may example po tayo dito. If the relative risk for lung cancer among smokers compared to non-smokers is 10, it means that smokers have 10 times higher risk of developing lung cancer compared to non-smokers. So nakita na po natin dito na 10 times siya, which is ang interpretation natin dito is increased risk. So this is summarized in 2x2 tables, so called 2 rows for exposure and 2 columns for the outcome. Ito po yung itong calculate the risk attack or risk rate natin is, ito po yung formula niya, attack rate for exposed is equal to A divided by A plus B. And for an unexposed group naman po is C divided by C plus D. Meron po tayong example mamaya dito. So at dito na po yung papasok yung formula natin kanina, which is RR is equal to risk in exposed group divided by risk in unexposed group. So example, in an outbreak of tuberculosis among prison inmates in South Carolina in 1999, 28 of 157 inmates residing on the east wing of the dormitory developed tuberculosis, compared with 4 of 137 inmates residing on the west wing. So meron tayong 28 dito, which is yung mga inmates na mayroong tuberculosis sa east wing. So saan nakuha itong 129? So bali, ang ginawa lang po namin is 157 minus 28, which is 128 yung nasa letter B po. So yung mga prison naman po na mayroong tuberculosis sa may west wing is 4, which is yung nasa letter C po. And then yung D is, nakuha lang din po siya sa 137 minus 4, which is 133. So dito na po yung risk of tuberculosis among east wing residents, which is yung formula natin kanina for exposed group is A divided by A plus B. And for unexposed is C divided by C plus D. So 28 divided by 157. Pinag-add lang po natin yung A and B is equivalent to 0.178 or 17.8. Sa unexposed group naman natin is 4. And pinag-add po ulit natin yung letter C and D, which is 137. 4 divided by 137 is equivalent to 0.029 or 2.9%. So yung sagot po natin dito sa exposed and unexposed group, dito na po natin siya i-divide sa my letter C, which is yung risk ratio. For the risk ratio, we have the risk in exposed group, which is yung 17.8. And risk in unexposed group, which is yung 2.9, is equal to 6.1. 6.1 for the interpretation is increased risk. Thus, inmates who resided in the east wing of the dormitory were 6.1 times as likely to develop tuberculosis as those who resided in the west wing. So another sample po. In a group of 200 people, 100 are exposed to high level of toxic pollutant. Out of those who were exposed to high pollution, 50 died within the next 20 years, and 50 did not. Out of those who were exposed to low pollution, 25 died within the next 20 years, and 75 did not. So sa high pollution, meron tayong 50 ang namatay sa high pollution din is meron tayong 50 ang hindi namatay. Ito yung nasa letter A and B. So sa mga nasa low pollution naman, meron tayong 25 died and 75 did not for a total of 100. So to calculate na naman yung exposed group, meron tayong dito na 50, which is yung A divided by A plus B, which is 50 divided by 100 is equal to 0.5 or 50%. For the unexposed or yung low pollution, we have 25 divided by 100 is equal to 0.25 or 25%. Sa ating risk ratio naman, 50 divided by 25, which is yung result kanina ng attack rate or risk attack natin kanina is 2. Thus, individuals who were exposed to toxic pollutant were 2 times as likely to survive the next 20 years. Another sample po is, in an outbreak of varicella or chickenpox in Oregon in 2002, varicella was diagnosed in 18 of 152 vaccinated children, compared with 3 of unvaccinated children. So meron tayong 18 na vaccinated na children and 134, which is no case, non-case po siya. Nakuha na naman natin yung 134 sa 152 minus 18. So same as true sa mga unvaccinated, meron tayong tatlo and tatlo sa unvaccinated and apat sa walang case. So same ano po, calculation for the risk attack or attack rate ng exposed and unexposed. 18 divided by 152 is equal to 0.118 or 11.8%, and 3 divided by 7 is equivalent to 0.428 or 42.8, and then yung naging result natin dito is i-compute natin dito para makuha ang risk ratio or relative risk niya, which is 0.27 decrease risk. The risk ratio is less than 1, indicating a decreased risk or protective effect for the exposed or vaccinated children. The risk ratio of 0.27 indicates that vaccinated children were only approximately 1/4 as likely, 27% actually, to develop varicella as were unvaccinated children. So we have 3 strengths and 3 limitations for the relative risk or risk ratio. We have number one strength is direct estimation of risk in cohort studies, easily interpretable as the ratio risk between exposed and unexposed groups, allows for comparison of disease incidence in exposed versus the unexposed groups over time. For the limitation, we have prospective cohort study design, which can be costly and time-consuming, susceptible to bias from loss to follow-up and confounding variables, cannot be calculated in case control studies directly. So for the next reporter would be Ma'am Almira po. Bali, i-share ko na lang po yung recorded lecture niyo.
Ma'am Angel, can you unshare, then you share again, then you click yung share sound when you share? Kasi walang sounds itong video ni Ma'am Almira.
Ay, sige po.
This call is now being recorded.
Okay, so hello everyone. Hello, ma'am. So the topic that was given to me was odds ratio. So I am going to discuss odds ratio. So odds ratio is a measure commonly used in case control studies to assess the association between exposure and outcome. It represents the odds of exposure among cases or individuals with outcome compared to the odds of exposure among controls or individuals without the outcome. So the odds ratio, in a simplified term, is a measure of association between exposure and outcome commonly used in epidemiological studies, especially in case control studies. It helps determine if the odds of a certain outcome is higher in the exposed group compared to the non-exposed group. So the formula for our odds ratio is odds ratio is equal to odds of exposure among cases divided by odds of exposure among controls. So we have here the interpretation: if your OR is equal to 1, you have no association. If OR is greater than 1, it has positive association. And for OR less than 1, has negative association. So odds ratio helps researchers to identify, number 1, potential risk factors, and number 2, guide hypothesis generation for further investigation. So we have an example here. So if the odds ratio for the association between alcohol consumption and liver cirrhosis is 3, it means that individuals who consume alcohol have 3 times higher odds of developing liver cirrhosis compared to those who do not. So nakita natin ang odds ratio niya is 3, so it has positive association. So ano ba yung in-associate natin? We have alcohol consumption and liver cirrhosis. So it is 3, it is greater than 1, it has positive association, meaning alcohol consumption and liver cirrhosis is related with each other. It has 3 times higher odds developing of liver cirrhosis if you consume alcohol. So we will have some examples here. So we have here odds ratio table. So we have here your expose, and this is the exposure, I should say, and this is the outcome. So lagi natin i-identify kung ano ang ating exposure and ano yung outcome natin. So this is an example. This is a 2x2 contingency table. So in our 2x2 contingency table, our formula for odds ratio will be A times D is divided by B times C, where A is the expose with disease. So ito po siya, expose with disease, we have letter A. So next is letter B, stands for expose without disease. So saan si B? Ito siya. Expose siya, pero wala siyang disease. That is letter B. Next naman is C, stands for unexposed with disease. So saan si letter C? Ito siya. Not exposed or unexposed, but meron siyang disease. That is letter C. And last, we have letter D. We have unexposed without the disease. So ito si letter D. Unexposed, no disease. That's letter D. So you need just to memorize this one po para mabilis lang natin i-compute yung odds ratio, kasi we are going to use the 2x2 contingency table. So we have an example here. Exposure and disease in a hypothetical population of 10,000 persons. So meron tayong expose, not expose, and we have your disease and no disease. So this is the 2x2 contingency table. So ano yung A natin? Ulitin natin. A is the expose with the disease. Expose with the disease, that is letter A. So A natin is equal to 100. Letter B is the expose with no disease. We have 1,900. We have letter C, unexposed but with disease, that's letter C, which is 80. And D, we have unexposed without the disease, 7,920. Ang gagawin lang po natin is ilalagay natin siya dito. So 8 times D, odds ratio is equal to A times D divided by B times C. Your A is 100 times letter D, 7,920, divided by your B is 1,900 times record C is 80. So, compute lang po natin. Hindi ata siya nakikita. Nakikita pa siya. So, 100 times 7, 7,920. 7,920 is equal to 792,000 divided by 1,900 times 80. It's 152,000. So, 792,000 divided by 152 is 1,000 divided by 152,000. It's 5.2. So, 5.2. So, we have here the OR or the odds ratio, we have 5.2. So, let's take an example po here. So, let's have an example. A study was conducted to examine the association between smoking and the development of lung cancer. The study involved 400 participants equally divided into two groups. You have 200 smokers and 200 non-smokers. Among the smokers, 50 individuals were diagnosed with lung cancer, while 150 were not. In the non-smoker group, 10 individuals developed lung cancer and 190 did not. Based on this data, calculate the odds ratio to determine the strength of association between smoking and lung cancer. So, we are going to identify what is the outcome and what is the exposure. So, yung outcome natin is we have your lung cancer. Pangit ng penmanship ko, sorry po. And next, we have the exposure is we have the smoking. So, kapag ipa-plot natin siya sa 2x2 contingency table natin, dito sa side na to is we have the exposure. And here sa taas naman po, we have the outcome. Okay, so tatandaan lang natin kung sino si A, sino si B, si C, and si D. Ulitin natin, A is your exposed with the disease. We have B is exposed without the disease. C is unexposed with disease. And letter D, unexposed without the disease. So meron tayo dito, we have here, sabi niya, 200 smokers and 200 non-smokers. Among the smokers, 50 individuals were diagnosed with lung cancer. So, exposed siya, tapos meron siyang lung cancer. Ilan sila? 50. So, A natin is 50. Next naman, while 150 were not. So, ibig sabihin, exposed sila, pero hindi sila nagka-lung cancer. So, that's letter B, 150. Next naman, in the non-smoker group, 10 individuals develop lung cancer. So, that's letter C. Unexposed but with the disease. That's letter C. 10 po sila. Next naman, and 190 did not. So, not exposed but and without lung cancer. That's 190. So, letter D, 190. So, ang gagawin lang po natin ay ilalagay siya doon sa ating formula. So, OR ulit is equal to A times D divided by B times C. Yung A po natin is 50 times your letter D, 190 divided by letter B is 150 times D, is 10. So, 50 times 190 is 9,500 divided by 150 times 10 is 1,500. So 9,500 divided by 1,500 is 6.33. So the OR is equal to 6.33. So what is the interpretation? So interpretation is smokers have 6.33 times the odds of developing lung cancer compared to non-smokers. Remember, 6.33, it is greater than 1. So kapag yung OR mo is greater than 1, it has positive association. So anong ibig pong sabihin nun? Associated ang lung, ang smoking sa lung cancer. So okay po. Okay. So I will give you po an example and you have 2 minutes to answer this one. So we have an example here. A hospital conducted a study to assess the relationship between high blood pressure and stroke risk. The study included 600 participants, 300 individuals with high blood pressure and 300 without it. Among those with high blood pressure, 80 suffered a stroke while 220 did not. In the group without high blood pressure, 20 experienced a stroke and 280 did not. Using this data, calculate the odds ratio to determine the association between high blood pressure and stroke risk. So you have 2 minutes po to answer this one. Okay, so let's have the solution. So first, we need to have kung sino ang exposure or kung ano I should say ang exposure and ano yung outcome natin. So the exposure is we have the high blood pressure. and the outcome is the stroke risk. So since ano natin ang exposure and outcome natin, nalagay natin siya sa contingency table. So we have with high blood pressure and without high blood pressure. Next naman, dito sa taas po natin is we have yung outcome. We have stroke risk and without stroke risk. So we have them. So, balikan natin yung passage natin. Sino, or ano yung letter A natin? Letter A is we have yung with the disease and with the exposure. So, sino sa kanila? Ang letter A natin, we have AT. Ito, this one. So, it has the disease and it also has exposure. So, si letter A natin is AT. Next naman po is we have letter B. So, what is letter B? It is the with exposure but without the disease. So, we have 220. We have 220. So, ilagay natin siya dito. Letter B is 220. Next naman, we have letter C, unexposed but with the disease. So, sino yung mga unexposed? So, without high blood pressure, 20 experience stroke. So, letter C natin is 20. And lastly, letter D, without exposure but without disease, we have 280. From this, we can calculate our OR. So, OR or odds ratio is equal to A times D divided by B times C. Our A is 80 times our D is 280 divided by B is 220 times letter C is 20. So, 80 times 280 is equal to 22,400 divided by 220 times 20 is 4,400. So, 22,400 divided by 4,400 is equal to 5.09. So, our odds ratio is equal to 5.09. So, what is the interpretation? So, since OR is greater than 1, it has positive association. So, in our interpretation, we could say that individuals with high blood pressure have about 5.09 times the odds of having a stroke compared to those without high blood pressure, indicating a strong association between high blood pressure and increased stroke risk. So, ang ibig sabihin po, kapag meron kang high blood pressure, you have a high chance of getting a stroke. Okay, next naman, another example. So, again, you have 2 minutes to answer this problem. So, we have here, a clinical trial was conducted to assess the effectiveness of a new drug in preventing heart attacks. The study involved 500 participants, half of whom were given the drug, while the other half received a placebo. Among those who received the drug, 30 experienced a heart attack, while 220 did not. In the placebo group, 70 participants had a heart attack and 180 did not. Using this data, calculate the odds ratio to evaluate the likelihood of heart attacks in those treated with the drug compared to those who received the placebo. You have 2 minutes to compute for the odds ratio. Okay, so let's compute for the odds ratio. So first, let's have the exposure and the outcome. So what is our exposure? So our exposure here is we have the drug. And the outcome is the heart attack. So let's make a 2x2 table or contingency table. So we have the exposure, we have the drug, and the without exposure, we have the placebo. Kasi diba, half is placebo ang binigay sa kanila. Next, the outcome naman is we have the heart attack. So the other one is without heart. So, ano yung letter A natin? Ano yung letter B, letter C, and letter D? So, in the passage, ang sabi niya dito, among those who received the drug or with exposure, ito yung with exposure natin, 30 experienced heart attack while 220 did not. Ibig sabihin, dun sa mga naka-receive ng drug or naka-receive ng exposure, 30 experienced heart attack while 220 na exposed did not experience heart attack. Next naman, we have the without exposure in the placebo group, or this is the without exposure. 70 participants had heart attack. So sa mga under placebo, 70 ang may heart attack, while 180 did not. So we are now ready to calculate for the odds ratio. So odds ratio is equal to A times D divided by B times C. Your A is 30 times 180 divided by B is 220 times your C, which is 70. So 30 times 180 is equal to 5,400 divided by 70 times 220 is equal to 15,400. 5,400 divided by 15,400 is equal to 0.35. So the odds ratio is 0.35. So since our OR is less than 1, it has negative association. What will be our interpretation here? So patients who were given the drugs have 0.35 times the odds of having heart attack compared to the patients given placebo, suggesting that the drug may be protective against the heart attack. So ibig sabihin, effective yung drug na ibinigay dun sa mga pasyente. So, we have 0.35, ibig sabihin mababa ang chance na magka heart attack yung mga pasyente na nagtake ng gamot. Okay. So, next, I think this is the last one. So, we have another example. So, again, you have 2 minutes to compute for the odds ratio. So, a research study was conducted to investigate the association between physical inactivity and obesity. A total of 800 people participated in the study, with 400 classified as physically inactive and 400 as physically active. Among the physically inactive group, 120 individuals were obese, while 280 were not. In the physically active group, 40 individuals were obese and 360 were not. Using this data, calculate the odds ratio to assess the relationship between physical inactivity and obesity. So you have 2 minutes to compute for the odds ratio. Okay, so let's compute for the odds ratio. So let's have the exposure and the outcome. So our exposure is the physical inactivity. And the outcome is we have the obesity. So we have here inactive, and we have the active group. So we have there the obese, and we have the fit. So let's make the contingency table. So what is our letter A, our letter B, C, and our D? So A natin, we have obese and inactive. So balik tayo sa passage. We have among the physically inactive group, 120 individuals were obese and 280 were not. So we have 120 and 280. Next, we have in the physically active group, 40 individuals were obese and 360 were not. So we have 40 here and 360. So let's calculate the odds ratio. A times D divided by B times C. Our A is 120 times D is 360 divided by 280 times C is 40. So 120 times 360 is equal to 43,000. 200 divided by 280 times 40 is 11,200. So 43,200 divided by 11,200 is 3.86. So the odds ratio is equal to 3.86. Since it is greater than 1, it has positive association. So what is the interpretation? So the interpretation is physically inactive individuals have about 3.86 times the odds of being obese compared to physically active individuals, suggesting a strong link between physical inactivity and obesity. So may positive association ang hindi pag-exercise at ang pagiging obese. So that's our odds ratio on how to compute for odds ratio. So what are the strengths of odds ratio? We have widely used in case control studies where the outcome is rare. Estimate of the odds of exposure among cases compared to controls. It is less sensitive to biases related to sampling and confounding than risk ratio. And we have the limitations. It is not a true estimate and can overestimate the association when the outcome is not rare. It does not directly measure incidence or risk in cohort studies. It is prone to selection bias and recall bias in case control studies. So the next one is we have the hazard exposure to be presented by my groupmate. So if you have any questions, just message me po or sa GC po natin. So thank you and God bless.
Ma'am Kimberly, okay po yun?
Meron pa pong isa, ma'am.
Meron pa pong isa po. Sige.
Hazard ratio. So, hazard ratio is the probability of an event in a treatment group relative to the control group probability over a unit of time. So, for example natin dito is medical treatment for cancer patients. So, pag binigyan ba natin ng gamot ang ating mga cancer patients, will it shorten or prolong their survival rate? Parang ganun siya. So, it is used in survival analysis or cohort studies where the outcome is tied to event data, such as time until death or disease recurrence. So, what is survival analysis? Survival analysis is a branch of statistics that studies the expected duration of time until an event occurs. So, ang example ng event na sinasabi dito is heart attack. So, kagaya ng sabi ko kanina, cancer, or for worst cases, death. So, hazard ratio is same with relative ratio and odds ratio in terms of comparing two groups. Risk and odds ratio only studies a disease at one point in time, but hazard ratio studies the time to event data. So, from this, makikita natin na ang hazard ratio is commonly used for clinical trials. For another example is recording the time span of a population entering the study of cancer until reaching the endpoint of the disease or death. So, as I said earlier, it is calculated in survival or time to event analysis in which the outcome variable is the time, such as days, months, years, and etc., until the occurrence of the event of interest, such as development of disease, disease complication, death, or another outcome. Hazard ratio also helps assess the effect of exposure on the timing of outcomes such as disease progression or mortality. So now in calculating hazard ratio, we will use the formula of hazard ratio is equal to hazard rate in treatment group divided by hazard rate in control group, where the hazard rate describes as the unwanted event in a short period of time. So in order to calculate the hazard ratio, we should calculate first the hazard rate of the treatment group and the control group. So, ang treatment group po natin dito is sila po yung mga tao na titake or nag-a-administer ng gamot, while yung control group naman po, sila po yung mga taong ayaw uminom ng gamot or any vaccinations. Kumbaga, sila po yung mga matitigas ang ulo na ayaw mag-take ng gamot. So, using the formula for the hazard rate, death divided by the total population of the group. So now we have an example here for the treatment group. There are 100 individuals, while in control group there is also 100 individuals. Where in treatment group there is 10 deaths, while in control group there is 50 deaths. So as I said earlier, we should first compute the hazard rate. So hazard rate of the treatment group is equal to 10. Divided by 100 is 0.1, while in hazard rate of control group there is 50 over 100 is equal to 0.5. So after computing the hazard rate of treatment group and control group, we will now compute the hazard ratio. Now using the formula of hazard rate of treatment group divided by hazard rate of control group, we will now use it for hazard ratio is equal to 0.1 divided by 0.5 is equal to 0.2. So in interpreting the hazard ratio, hazard ratio of 1 is equal to no difference, which means that both treatment group and control group has the same rate of the event. For easier understanding na lang po natin, yung number po na namatay sa treatment group is same as the control group. Now, sa hazard ratio greater than 1 or higher hazard, which means that the treatment group has a higher death rate than the control group. Dito po natin nakikita na hindi po effective yung medication na binigay sa patient since mas mataas po ang death rate ng treatment kesa sa control group. Lastly po, sa hazard ratio less than 1, lower hazard naman po, which means that there is a lesser death in treatment group than in control group. Dito po natin makikita naman na yung medications po na binigay natin sa ating patients ay effective since it has a lower death rate. So now, in interpreting this example, since 0.2 po siya, which means that there is a lesser death in treatment group than in control group. So we have another example here. The study was conducted in Tuguegarao City where 2,000 individuals received the COVID-19 vaccination and 2,150 individuals preferred not to. After 3 days of vaccinations, 150 recipients of the COVID-19 vaccine and 322 recipients of the non-vaccination received the same condition. Determine the group's hazard ratio. First, as I said earlier, we need to compute the hazard rate of treatment or control group with the formula death divided by the total population. So, for the hazard rate of treatment group, 150 over 2,000 is equal to 0.0175, while in hazard rate of control group, 322 divided by 2,150 is equal to 0.15. After calculating the hazard rate of treatment and control group, we will now compute the hazard ratio with the formula of hazard rate in treatment group divided by hazard rate in the control group. So, hazard ratio is equal to 0.0175 divided by 0.15 is equal to 0.5. So, in interpreting this answer, 0.5, there is half of death in the treatment group versus the control group. And lastly, for the hazard ratio, the strength and limitations. For strengths, number 1, suitable for the time to event data and survival analysis. Number 2, accounts for censoring and carrying follow-up times. Number 3, allows for comparison of hazards between exposed and unexposed groups. For limitations, number 1, longitudinal data and assumes proportional hazards over time. Number 2, challenging in interpretation, especially when hazards are not constant over time. Lastly, influenced by competing risks and changes in exposure status over time. That's all po. Thank you. Sana po may natutunan po tayo kahit papano. Thank you po.
Thank you so much, Ma'am Angel, Ma'am Almira, and Ma'am Kimberly. So before we move on to the activity for this afternoon, meron bang familiar sa inyo dun sa ginagamit na app na OpenEd? Kung meron, mag-heart na lang. Ay, saan bang aking kayo? Meron po ba? OpenEd. Wala. So, before we go to the activity, I'll just share itong part na to so that meron naman tayong matutunan kahit papaanong bago sa ating... Ayan, nakikita ba yung screen ko? I'm sharing the whole screen.
Yes, ma'am.
Sige. Yes, ma'am. So, you can download this. OpenEpi.com or www.openepi.com. This is free. Free po to. So, para sa ating mga nag-aaral ng epidemiology, very useful itong site na ito sa atin. You can download actually para kahit walang wifi, pwede natin itong magamit. Pero yung sa akin kasi, naka-bookmark na lang siya sa akin dito. So, lagi siyang nandito. Gamit to sa akin kapag nag check ako ng sample size, ito, makikita nyo dito. So, kapag gumagawa ko ng mga research at need ko ng sample size, I just enter here. So, yan. And then, calculate siya. So, I know for that specific confidence level, meron tayo ilan dapat yung sample size na gagamitin. But, for today, hindi yun ang ating titingnan. Itong undercounts, 2x2 table. Ito yung tinatawag kanina nila, Ma'am Almira, na contingency table. So, pag meron na kasi tayo ng contingency table, it's easy already for us to compute for the odds ratio and the risk ratio using this site. So, here, i-plug in mo lang yung values. So, if... Siyempre, hindi ko pala makita, no? Sa ating book, for example, I'll just... Ayan. Sa ating module, tingnan natin yung sample dito sa risk ratio. So, sabi dito, sa kung nag-develop ba ng tuberculosis, computing for the risk ratio sa ating... Wala kang page number. I hope hindi nakikita pala. Sa book natin on page 1, 2, 3, 4, may example dyan on calculating risk ratios. And then you have the table there na merong developed tuberculosis, yes or no. So that is disease positive, nag-develop ng tuberculosis, and negative pag hindi nag-develop. And then nakalagay kung sa east wing or sa west wing sila nakalagay. So, we just put the values there. 28, 4, 129, at saka 133. So, after that, you just press calculate. So, dito, asan ma'am yung risk ratio? So, sa book natin nakalagay, ang risk ratio sa baba is 17.8 over 2.9, that is 6.1. So, yung risk ratio natin dito, hindi nakikita, pero andun siya. Ito, risk ratio sa pinakababa is 6.108. So, 6.1. So, same tayo. So, kapag ganito, you can screenshot itong part na to. Yan. Parang cheat sheet tong open epi natin. You can screenshot, tapos yun na yung ilalagay mo sa mga output mo. Or you can compute manually, katulad ng ginawa nila Ma'am Angel kanina, tsaka ni Ma'am Almira. We try also for odds ratio. We just clear that. Then, tingnan natin yung example din sa odds ratio natin, sa module natin. So, sa odds ratio nakalagay, Ayan, may table siya with disease and without the disease, kung exposed and not exposed. So, nakalagay dito 100, 1,900, 80, tsaka 7,920. Tingnan natin kung pareho. Okay, so sa book natin, the odds ratio computed, actually nag-compute siya ng risk ratio and odds ratio. For risk ratio, sabi niya 5. Sa odds ratio, sabi niya 5.2. So tingnan natin dito. So risk ratio here is 5, makikita niyo dyan. And then the odds ratio, ayan, makikita niyo 5.211. Okay. Wala pa bang example natin dito? Wala tayong example for the hazard ratio here. Okay. May questions tayo sa open epi. Lahat ba naka-laptop ngayon? Pwedeng ma-navigate or ma-try itong open epi natin? So for this afternoon, you'll have a group activity. Magkakaroon tayo ng breakout rooms. I'll be sending sa ating GC yung groupings natin. So, pwedeng anim kayo or pito in a group. Okay, Facebook. Facebook. Hello, sir. Okay, so can you see po nasa ating GC na yung groupings ninyo? Okay. So, ang instruction natin sa ating activity for today. Just share. Yan, share natin. So, meron tayong QR codes for groups 1 to 6. So, each QR code merong scenario for each group to compute. So compute either risk ratio, odds ratio, hazards ratio, depending on the scenario. And then you will be presenting yung iyong output through one slide or two slides, PowerPoint presentation ito after 10 minutes. So 10 minutes lang ang given sa atin to to do the activity. You can use yung open epi if you have already, or you can do also yung manual na pinakita kanina nila Ma'am Almira na way of computing your measures of association. Mag-breakout room ako, anim to. Okay, you choose yung room ninyo depending on the group number na meron tayo sa list. Kindly join po sa rooms niya so that you have a way to communicate with your group mates.